Welcome to IC Beda. We are so happy you are tuning in with us online. My name is Shindy.
And I'm Josh.
And we are part of the team here. We are so thankful that you are here. Give someone a shout out and lighten up the chat room. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for being a generous church all through these years. We are so grateful for your faithful giving and generosity. Especially during these times, our mission will continue and we will keep spreading the good news through people in this community and in this city. You can give via online transfer or scan our QR code and find more information on icmedan.com/giving.
Jangan lupa kalau kita sudah menambahkan subtitle atau terjemahan bahasa Indonesia ke dalam video kami. Kalian tinggal klik tombol caption atau CC di bawah ini.
Now let's lean in, take some notes, eliminate all distraction, and let's take some time to worship.
You are my champion, giants for when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence, I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered. Tried so hard to see it. It took me so long to believe it. That you choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve. Take the broken things and raise them to glory. You are my champion, giants for when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say. My victory, and now I can finally see it. You're teaching me how to receive it. So let all the striving cease. This is my victory. Has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority that Jesus has given me. And when I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority that Jesus has given me.
Such an awesome thing that God's word says that we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. And because of him, it doesn't matter what kind of things are going on or the things that we face in our life, that because of Jesus, we can overcome. And so, man, what an awesome reminder for us today is that with God on our side, that we can face anything and he'll help us, and he is our champion, and he'll help us to overcome it. this next few minutes, let's just open our hearts and just worship the Lord. We're going to sing this song. And it just says that I'm available. And that's what our prayer is today, that we would come before God and come before His throne and say, God, I am available. Let's worship the Lord together.
I am available.
for the one who gave me life. Nothing is a sacrifice. Use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart. I hear you call, I am available. I say yes, Lord, I am
change.
Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us, for your love, God, for the cross that you bore. God, there's nothing that we could ever do or we could ever say to thank you enough, God. But Lord, we're just so grateful for you today, Lord, that God, you are our God. You're our Heavenly Father. And God, you're everything that we need. So Lord, we just want to worship you, Lord. We want to praise your name today. And God, I pray that, Lord, today as we listen to your word, that God, Lord, things would be spoken to our hearts, that, Father, you would change us, oh God. Lord, I pray that, God, the words, Lord, would pierce our hearts today, Father. And God, I thank you, Lord, God, for what you're going to do. I thank you for this message, Lord. I thank you for every person that is watching right now, Lord. Would you touch them? Would you bless them, Father? In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. We hope you have an awesome Sunday. Enjoy the service and God bless you.
Hey guys, welcome to Church at Home. I'm so excited to see you again. We are still in the Hey Jude series. This is week number six, I think. We had 4 weeks of Hey Jude, and this is a book study from the book of Jude. And then we took a break and did Everything's Gonna Be Okay. Is everything gonna be okay, guys?
Yeah.
Anyway, it was a good break. And then this is week six of Hey Jude, and if you recognize over the last few weeks of this series, it's all a warning for the church from Jude, and we'll get into that, but I was thinking about, don't you hate it when you see an out of order sign? Do you ever see, like, when you see a sign that says something is out of order, or, you know, I hate that feeling. Normally, it's on a bathroom door when you really, really need to go. Have you ever been like at a mall or something and you've just been walking around, maybe not so much lately, but drinking a Starbucks or something, and then you need the restroom and you run to a floor with a restroom and it's out of order, and then you're having to go up escalators trying to find the, it's out of order signs. I really hate seeing that. Or an ATM machine when you are out of cash. I've had that happen several times because I need a specific machine and I get there, no cash. Carrie and I have had some crazy experiences with that. I don't even want to get into. My least favorite out of order sign is on an escalator. Oh. Do you hate that when you get to the escalator? I mean, I know maybe in 2020 we're just lazier people, but when I see it and I'm like, oh man, I've actually got to walk up it like stairs. I mean, you can still use an out of order escalator, but it's just so, I mean, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago. And in this time with the pandemic, we all have to wear the masks, and the escalator is out of order. I had to walk up like 2 flights of escalators. I felt like I was going to have a heart attack at the top. Like, I'm leaned over, trying to pull the mask down. I needed like an oxygen tank, like an athlete. I felt like an athlete. I had only gone up some flights of escalators that were out of order. This is another type of out of order I was thinking about. You know, there's order in things, like, you know, in recipes, there's sometimes an order. Something has to come first and something has to go next. What would you guys do if I had walked in here today and my underwear was outside of my jeans?
You know,
like, it's only a superhero. You're right. Only a superhero can get away with that. And let me tell you, single guys, this is why it is so important to find a good wife, because I planned on doing that and my wife stopped me. My wife saves me from so much humiliation. I'm like looking in the underwear drawer thinking, which one am I going to wear? And I'm explaining, it's an illustration. She's like, no, don't do that. Just tell the story. But imagine, I mean, not only would it make us all awkward and uncomfortable, you wouldn't just think my clothes were out of order. You would think I had some kind of mental disorder, right? Like, what's going on here? Who can we call to come lead the church? Because Pastor Chris is wearing his underwear outside of his pants. But the point is, order is important. I mean, when things get out of order, it just throws everything into chaos. Order is important. There's purpose in the order. And our God is a God of order. I mean, when you read the Bible, you see there's order, there's structure. Even in creation, there was order, there was purpose, there was a reason for how things were done. There's structure and order all throughout the Bible. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 33, it even says, "For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace." He's not a God of disorder. Our God is not a God of chaos and confusion and there's no structure. We just do whatever you want and everything's crazy. He's a God of order, and in the order, it brings peace. When we have order, that's why in your life, when you are in order with God, you can have peace in the midst of chaos. We can have peace in the midst of a pandemic. I mean, it can be a crazy year like we're in right now, and we can have peace if we're living in order with God. Isaiah 26:3 says, "You keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you." Because if our thoughts are on God and we trust him, then our life is in order and we will have peace. If every day, if we keep our mind fixed on God, things will be in order. We'll be living the right way, and it gives us peace. So escalators being out of order, you know, clothes out of order, all of that is funny, but when you get out of order with God, it's a serious thing. When we get out of God's order, it's called rebellion. None of us like to think about the word rebellion. We know rebellion is bad. It is opposition to authority. It's defiance. It's resistance. Being in rebellion against God is so serious, it's even related to witchcraft. I mean, you see in the scripture in 1 Samuel 15, 23a, it says, "For rebellion is as bad as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as bad as worshiping idols." And that's tough if you're sitting here and you're like, "Wow, I'm a pretty stubborn person. Am I a witch?" You know? You know, but rebellion is the same as witchcraft, the Bible tells us. And most of us, I know everyone here, and I believe most of you at home, you would say, "There's no way I would be involved in witchcraft. There's no way I would be involved in idol worship." But when we see the scripture and we see when we just rebel against God, it's the same thing. When we get out of God's order, it's the same thing as witchcraft. So here we are in Hey Jude, week 6. We're looking at Jude's final example. He gives these examples of people that have fallen away from God's truth, people who have fallen away from the faith, people who are trying to lead other people away. One of the scriptures in the Bible says that they try to recruit disciples themselves, trying to lead people into this false faith or this false truth. The apostates. And in Jude 1:11, which is where the last 3 weeks of Jude have come from, it says, "Woe to them. They have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error." You remember Last week we were talking about Balaam. He was all about profit. What can I get? How can I make a deal with God? And then the last one is they have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. So here we are. We're going to look at this example Jude is giving us. And if you remember, the three who fell from the truth that Jude gives the example of, they were all guilty of these things, rebelling against God's authority, rationalizing or justifying sin, and rejecting God's messenger. So here's the rebellion of Korah. Moses was chosen. He's leading God's people. He was called to lead God's people. And if you remember Moses' story, he didn't even want the position. I mean, if you remember this, he wasn't looking for a role. He wasn't looking for leadership. He wasn't looking for a position. He didn't seek power. He wasn't seeking honor. He wasn't looking for the top place or the special seat. He didn't want to be in front of everyone. When God chose him, he was even saying, God, I don't think I'm the right one. I can't even speak clearly. But God chose him. God called him. God gave him the position, the power, and the honor. Have you ever noticed in life that when God lifts you up, there's always people around you who do not celebrate you? Have you ever noticed that when God does something good in your life and there's someone standing around you, they don't have a smile on their face? I mean, hopefully all of us here, if we share some good news and I came in and said, baby, God really blessed me this week and this thing happened, I know you'd be excited for me. But have you ever told someone, man, God's doing something in my life, and they're like, mm-hmm, yeah, whatever. You know, there's always people like that. Moses had a man like that in his life, and you can guess it's Korah. He had this, and Korah is believed to be his cousin. You ever feel that when you've got someone close to you? You know, in church sometimes it's a brother or sister. You know, it could be someone in your family, someone that's close to you that should be excited when something good happens. But they're not. So Moses has this guy, Korah. Korah is bitter. He is jealous. He is power hungry. And as a matter of fact, let me just stop and give you this system to use to determine who your real friends are. I mean, we all need to know this, right? When we know there are people with a Korah spirit around us, there's Korahs around us. It's just how the world is. Sometimes we can be like Korah. And that's why we want to look at this warning so God forbid we're like this. God forbid someone would tell us, hey, God's really doing something in my life, and because he's not doing it for me, I'm not happy. So here's the thing. When God blesses you, watch for those who celebrate you. Watch for those who criticize you. Watch for those who compete with you. That's how you'll know who's my real friend. It's the one celebrating with you. If it's the one when you're like, hey, I got this new sweater for 80,000 rupiah shindy. And you're like, oh yeah, I got one for 60. That's happened to all of us. Come on, guys. But that's sort of just light. But there's things that happen. Like, man, God did this thing and someone wants to compete or they want to criticize. The one that's your real friend is the one that celebrates. Like, man, I'm so excited for you. Okay, when you face struggles, watch who leaves, who laughs, and who loves. And when you're in a struggle and someone's laughing behind your back, like, look what happened to them. They were even serving in the church. Man, those aren't your real friends. Look at who leaves quickly. They're with you, you know. If anyone remembers, like, I can remember in high school, I had friends younger than me. When I got my driver's license, man, I had a lot of friends. When they got their driver's license, I didn't see them as much. You know what I mean? Like, you know, but in your life, sometimes when you face struggles or, you know, when someone needs you or you have something to offer them or you can give something, man, they're right there with you. Roy, and I want to be with you all the way. And then when you're in a struggle, leaving. You can't give me anything else. You realize, man, that's not my real friend. And it hurts when those things happen. It's painful. It's disappointing. It's frustrating. And we see this all around us. The Korah spirit is the spirit of someone who will be a critic when you have success and who will laugh at you when you have a struggle. That's the Korah spirit. And Moses has to deal with this. And it was painful for Moses too. I mean, Moses is leading the people. He didn't even want to do it. God called him to do it. And he's leading, and he's got Korah talking about him behind his back constantly. Korah, his own cousin, so bitter, talking behind him. And the Bible says Korah carried away other people. He carried them away because, like anyone who's bitter, they can't be bitter alone. You know? You got to tell someone, Kosi, I need you to be bitter with me. Tell Riandi about it. And you want to build a team. You want to build your bitter team. And Korah is doing this, and people were carried away, and he led them away from the truth. He confronted Moses in Numbers chapter 16, verse 3, and he basically goes to Moses, and he's like, hey, why do you get to be honored? But why you? You ever feel like people have that feeling sometimes? Why do you get to be honored? Why do you get to lead? Aren't we all the same? I mean, Korah would say, aren't we all God's people? Why do you get to be the priest? Why do you get to lead everyone? Why do you get this? And Moses falls on his face before God. We read it in the scripture. He falls on his face because Korah doesn't realize what he's doing, but Moses realizes that Korah has dishonored God. Moses falls on his face immediately. God is a God of honor. He places people in position of leadership and authority. And by Korah questioning Moses, by him questioning Moses being in position, he was ultimately questioning God's judgment. You know, I mean, he didn't see it that way, but Moses realized it and fell on his face because he knew God put me here. So for Korah to be opposing me, he's opposing God. And Moses tells him this. Moses tells Korah, tomorrow the Lord will choose between us. The Lord will choose. Korah, we're going to meet tomorrow. Moses wasn't going to do anything. He just said, let's meet. Let's let God choose. In Numbers 16:11, Moses said, it is against the Lord that you and all your followers have banded together. Who is Aaron that you should grumble against him? He was saying, why would you be grumbling against me and my brother Aaron? Who are we? You're in opposition with God. You're rebelling against God himself. In Numbers 16:19-21, it says, when Korah had gathered all his followers in opposition to them at the entrance to the tent of meeting, the glory of the Lord appeared to the entire assembly. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, separate yourselves from this assembly so I can put an end to them at once. If you're ever on the other side when God says, hey, everyone back up, I'm going to put an end to this, you should change sides really quickly. I mean, could you imagine? There had to be someone standing there with Korah, like, would it be inappropriate for me to go follow Moses now? You wonder what happened there. And then the ground split apart, the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them. And this wasn't just a small number of people. Korah had led 250 people away with him. His bitterness, it spread. He was talking, hey, can you believe Moses is doing this and Moses is leading like that? Pass it on. And people are building up and they're rising up. And you can't rise up against what God has put in order. It's not going to turn out well for you. So today's message is called A Bitter Pill to Swallow, for obvious reasons. And this is a terrifying story. It's terrifying. I mean, there's no other story that will make you want to check your heart. God, I mean, you hear the ground swallowed them up. God, search my heart, oh God. You're like, may purify me, Lord. Make sure I have none of Korah's spirit. Jude gives this warning that's as relevant today as it was back then because this Korah spirit is still all around us. So Korah's rebellion was, or his spirit is, a lust for position. Korah wanted position. Korah wanted power. He worshiped the spotlight. I mean, that's what he wanted. He wasn't thinking about ministry. He wasn't thinking about the people. He wasn't thinking about anything. All he was thinking of is, man, I want to be on the stage under the lights just like Moses is, and everyone will see me. And instead of saying, Moses, Moses, they'll be saying, Korah, Korah. And that's his whole dream. He had no idea what it was he wanted. He had no idea what he was asking for. He just wanted to be the leader. I mean, rebellion is the same as witchcraft because they are both about power. Korah wanted power. He worshiped power. He wanted Moses' position. I mean, imagine that. God chose Moses, and in Korah's heart, he's saying, I want what God gave him. I want what he's got. And position without God's power brings destruction. I mean, that's a reminder for all of us. I would never want to lead this church without God's anointing and power. I wouldn't do this. I would be scared to death to stand here. I wouldn't want to lead it. As a matter of fact, when we talk to church planters, the first thing we tell them is, you better have a calling from God. Because if you want position without God's power, it will destroy. There's destruction. So here's Korah, not called. Moses was, and that's what made him bitter. He had a heart poisoned by bitterness and envy. Korah wants to lead. Korah wants to be honored. Korah wanted respect. Korah wanted position and power and prestige. Korah wanted what God had given someone else. And envy is a dangerous thing because it leads to bitterness. Be very careful when you are jealous of what God does for someone else. When we feel that, we've got to, I feel some Korah coming on. I need to push that down. God, take that out of me. Take that out of me. Be very careful when you envy another Christian's calling. Korah had no idea of the weight that Moses carried. Remember, the one that cared about Moses was his father-in-law because he saw, wow, yeah, he's leading. Yeah, there's some honor there, but he was carrying a tremendous weight. For Korah to even say in his heart, I want that, he had no idea what he was talking about. The weight that Moses carried would have crushed Korah, would have destroyed him. Some people envy what I do. It is hard what I do. It is not all about standing here and looking at a camera or when we're in the church, being on the stage. I never wanted this. I liked what I did before. I do this because God called me to do it. And I can tell you, with the weight of this, I would never do it without knowing God called me to do it. We have to be careful when we envy. Korah saw the spotlight and wanted it, but the weight of Moses' calling would have crushed him. Would have crushed him. Korah, like most bitter people, or most people with bitterness in his heart, had to pass it on. So it reminds us, be very careful what voices you allow in your life. Those who became bitter, listen to this, this is good. Those who became bitter with Korah were also buried with him. I mean, that is a scary thing. The other ones, they may not have really even felt it that strong. You know, Korah wants to be the leader. Yeah, I got a few complaints or gripes myself. I'll go with Korah. Everyone who was bitter with Korah joining his team, they were also buried with him. Every one of them went into the ground and it swallowed them up. In Numbers 16:26, he warned the assembly, move back from the tents of these wicked men. Do not touch anything belonging to them, or you will be swept away because of all of their sins. Be careful who you surround yourself with. When people start whispering bitterness, get away. It could be a close friend. Just say, hey, I can't take that. I don't listen to bitter stuff in my life. I don't have any room for it. I don't have time for that. I want some positive stuff. I want to hear something honoring, something that lifts up. Korah had a life full of disorder. He was out of order. His entire life was full of disorder. You could call it the Korah disorder. They are arrogant and always right, always smarter, always know better. Any of you guys know people like that? You talk to someone, they always know the better way to do it. Oh, you love having those people around you. They whisper and cause division. They lift themselves up. You don't even have to say anything good about them. They're already talking good about themselves. That's Korah. They get close to leadership to try and influence them. Most leaders see through that. They don't get really close. Maybe I can move you this way. And a lot of flattering and things like that. They are fault finders, always critics. I mean, imagine Moses. For all of us, an example in Scripture, Moses is one of the greatest leaders in history. Korah criticized every move he made. Korah was his critic. I mean, imagine if you are known as the critic of one of the greatest leaders in the entire world. You look like an idiot, you know? You're like, oh, Korah had no idea what's going on. They challenge authority with a questioning spirit. You know, there's nothing wrong with asking questions. The questioning spirit is questioning every move someone makes. It's a questioning just to question their authority, not the decision. And they cannot function under authority. Most people with a Korah spirit don't want to serve on a team. They want to start something themselves. They can't function under authority. They can't have a leader above them. They don't recognize authority. Korah didn't recognize Moses as his leader, even though God put Moses there. Korah never recognized it. They can't function. If you have that Korah spirit, you can't function on a team. You can't function with a leader. If you're not leading, you're out. And when you have that heart, you need to say, God, get that out of me. Get Korah out of me. The Korah disorder, or the spirit of Korah, is a rebellion that targets leadership to strip leaders of influence and authority. I mean, people with that spirit, they can't stand it if someone else has influence. They can't stand it if someone else is doing something for God, so they will constantly just go to someone else and tell them everything that, oh, I think he's doing this wrong, or I think he's doing that wrong. That's what Korah was doing. Hey, do you like how Moses did that? I think Moses could have done this better, or I think, you know, maybe the camera angle should be like that on Moses, and maybe the lights could have been different. And do you like electric or acoustic, or, you know, all of those. Korah is still around today. I mean, Korah, his spirit is everywhere. And we have to know how to deal with it. And in our own heart, we have to know how to not be like the one that was so bitter he was swallowed up by the earth. Korah had basically raised up these 250 men by talking behind the leader's back. 250. He built his own ministry where he was the leader. And it was all out of God's order. It was all out of order. They show no honor to leadership. They recognize no authority over their lives. They use their words to dishonor. The scary part is that Moses made it very clear that Korah was not dishonoring him. He was dishonoring God. That's the scary part. When we let this get into our heart, we're not attacking Moses. We're not attacking the leader. We're attacking God. How do we respond? Check your motives. I mean, in everything we do, everything we say, we have to check our motives. Proverbs 16:2 says, all a person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. Korah wasn't getting away with anything. God knew exactly what Korah was doing. Some people are around Korah thinking, you know what? I think Korah's way is better. God wasn't fooled by anything. The earth swallowed him up. When David fought Goliath, I mean, talk about motives. We talked about David just a few weeks ago. When he fought Goliath, this is why he said he was going to defeat him, so that the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And that's some motive. David battled Goliath not to reveal his own greatness. It was to reveal God's greatness. He fought Goliath. Hey, I'm going to do this so people will see how great God is, not how great David is. He even said, I'm not even going after him with a sword and a spear. I'm going in the name of the Lord. We have to check our motives. The second thing we have to do is keep a humble heart. While Korah was puffed up and arrogant, Moses was on his face before the Lord. While Korah was lifting himself up, I'm going to lead, Moses humbled himself. When he heard what was going on, he immediately fell face down. Proverbs 29:23 says, pride brings a person low, but the lowly in spirit gain honor. And when you think about pride bringing low, you couldn't get any lower than the center of the earth. I mean, Korah was brought low from his pride, and it's a warning to all of us to check our hearts. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. I mean, that's the heart we should all have, that we don't want to be lifted up unless God lifts us up. I don't want to lift Chris up. I want to put myself out there. God, put me wherever you want. Lift me up, lower me down. Just let me be in your will. But if we ever have the heart, I got to lift me up. I got to lift myself up. We have to humble ourselves. Moses' humility brought him honor. Humility is the key to honor. I mean, in a worldly sense, it doesn't even make sense. But for God, this makes complete sense because he's the one that allows us to have honor. So if we want to be honored, we need to be humble. The third thing is to live a life full of honor. Honor God. You honor God by putting him first. You honor others by putting them second to God. We read this in Romans 12. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. And then honor with your words. When Korah used his words to dishonor, we should always use our words to honor. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, it says, do not use harmful words, but only helpful words, the kind that build up and provide what is needed, so that what you say will do good to those who hear you. Our words should be used to bring honor. Our words should be good, used for good. Our words should be used to build up. If we ever use our tongues, if we ever use our words to tear down, we are on some very dangerous ground because we're allowing the spirit of Korah to come up. We need to use our words to honor. Remember, God will never give you something that you don't give others. I mean, that's just a good reminder for all of us. When you think about that, and scripture, there's so many scriptures about it. God will never give you something you don't give others. So if you give forgiveness, you will be given forgiveness. I mean, that's an important thing. We know in scripture, it says that if you don't forgive others, I won't forgive you. If you give grace, you will be given grace. How many of us here need grace? Then we should show it to other people. If you give mercy, you will be given mercy. If you give honor, you will be given honor. If you give it, you'll receive it. And then the fourth and final point today before we close, let God be your defender. This is the greatest thing that Moses did because Korah is talking behind his back. Korah is bitter. He's leading everyone. Hey, you shouldn't follow Moses. You should follow me. You shouldn't do it Moses' way. You should do it my way. He's talking. I mean, you guys, all of us here, we've had people talk behind our back, right? Or with someone here, you've never experienced that pain. We've all experienced it. I mean, the pain that Moses had to experience through that situation, but Moses didn't fight back. He let God defend him. I love this quote from a pastor that Pastor Carrie follows, Bianca Olthoff. She said, people aren't going to like everything about me. I'm not Nutella. That's a good quote. People aren't going to like everything about you. I mean, Korah did not like very much about Moses. It didn't change the fact that God put Moses in leadership. We realize even when we are doing everything we're supposed to do and we are in the position God put us into and we're walking with God, there's going to be people that don't like us. We have to be okay with that. We have to be like Moses and let God defend you. Don't fight. Don't get even. Don't seek revenge. Don't start posting on social media. I mean, nowadays, oh, someone talking about me? Instagram story. Don't do it. Moses didn't. Did anyone see an Instagram story from Moses? No. Moses would have had to do it on a stone, right? Dear Korah. He didn't do any of that. Be like Moses, who humbled himself and let God defend him. In Numbers 16:5, it says, then he said to Korah and all his followers, In the morning, the Lord will show who belongs to him and who is holy. And he will have that person come near him. The man he chooses, he will cause to come near him. Man, when you let God defend you, and you say, hey, I'll just let God decide. And he will show who is holy, and he will show who is with him, and he will draw that person to him. Psalm 62, 5-7 says, I depend on God alone. I put my hope in him. He alone protects and saves me. He is my defender, and I shall never be defeated. Man, isn't that the coolest thing? When we get out of the way, when we stop trying to fight for ourselves, then God will defend us and we will never be defeated. It says, my salvation and honor depend on God. Moses' honor didn't depend on anything he could do or say. His honor depended on God. Your honor depends on God. He is my strong protector. He is my shelter. And then the last example, even from Jesus himself, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23, we see that Jesus, when he was insulted, he did not answer back with an insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he placed his hopes in God, the righteous judge. When you place your hope in God, when you let God defend you, when you place your hope in God, your hope is in order, your God is your defender, and you will never be defeated. And is that good news? We're going to face struggles in our life. We're going to have opposition. James 4, 6 says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. We have to keep ourselves humble and let God be our defender. Let's pray. Father, I'm so thankful. Lord, as we continue in this study of the book of Jude, Lord, I know that you have brought us into this book for a reason, in this time and in this season. Lord, I believe that the same warning that you gave through Jude to the church, you are giving it to us. And Lord, I pray that you will teach us today, that this word would be in our heart and it would change who we are. Lord, that it would change our hearts. Lord, that we would recognize this spirit of Korah and we would not let it rise up in our own hearts. Lord, that we would not be bitter. Lord, that we wouldn't whisper behind people's backs and try to make other people bitter as well. But today we repent and say, God, take that out of us. And Lord, teach us to know how to deal with the Korahs around us. Lord, every single one of us, we have Korahs in our life. We have people around us who seek to destroy us, who seek to speak badly about us, Lord. But help us to just release that and trust you. Lord, those who are near us, Lord, help us to be humble enough that we can pray for them. Lord, that we could fall on our face before you, even for them, and lift up their name to you and say, Father, help them. Maybe they don't even know what they're doing. Lord, I pray that you would help us today to be changed by this warning from Jude. Lord, I pray that we would do these things that you've instructed us, Lord. And the most important thing of all, Lord, I believe that we would allow you to be our defender. So Lord, right now, everyone at home that is struggling, everyone who has felt attacks from around them, Lord, who have felt the pain of the whispers behind their back, everyone who has felt like someone has betrayed them or hurt them, Lord, right now I pray in Jesus' name that they would let go of all of that, release every single bit of it, and let you be their defender. Lord, for all of us here right now, Lord, we will let you defend us. We surrender the right to be angry or bitter. We give up the right to get even or to take revenge. We pray that you will be our defender and that, Lord, you will silence the enemies in our life. Father, keep us humble and make us holy. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. All right, guys, thank you so much for being here with me today. It makes me feel a lot stronger to deliver God's message, not being alone. And thank all of you guys for joining us. I pray that God will bless you, that you will humble yourself before him and let him lift you up. God bless you. I'll see you next Sunday.
Hey church, what an encouraging message we had today. Thank you so much for joining us online, and we love having you as a part of our church.
Before we let you go, first thing, if you made a decision today, you'd like to know more about Jesus, or if there's anything you need prayer for, we honestly love to connect with you, encourage you, and pray with you. So feel free to click on that link. Our prayer team would love to pray for you.
Last thing, let's join our Zoom lobby hangout now after the service. Stop by and say hello to our IC Maiden family and friends.
Once again, thank you so much for joining us today. We will be praying for you, and we will see you right back here this time next week.
Happy Sunday, everyone! We love you all!